والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد. Today we continue in the list of the groups we're studying, the sixth and seventh from the firq, from the groups. And today we studied two very influential groups in bid'ah. And they were not good influences on the ummah, but they had a very lasting influence. The first, it's called the Jahmiyyah, and the second is called the Murji'. Now, many of us may think we know who the Jahmiyyah are and who the Murji' are because we hear these terms, but in reality, we don't know them. And when we talk about them, you will realize that their aqidah was much worse than what you would think. And then, I want to mention that many people don't consider them to be a factor today. But in reality, the influence of the Jahmiyyah and the Murji' are both around today all over the Muslim world. Inshallah, we'll show that. And this was such an important subject that Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, the great Imam and Muhaddith, he wrote a book, The Rad ala Jahmiyyah. Rad, يعني a refutation to the Jahmiyyah. And Imam Bukhari, in his Sahih, he put a bab as a rad on the Jahmiyyah. And many a'imma, they wrote entire books as a rad on the Jahmiyyah. So it tells us that's a very important subject. And I'm saying that because some of the du'at today, who go out and ascribe knowledge to themselves, they make light of this. When you talk about the Jahmiyyah or the Murji' or the Mu'tazila, they say, oh, those things are finished. But in reality, not only are they not finished, but their bid'ah was an important enough subject that great a'imma dedicated abwab or chapters or entire kutub or books to make rad on them. The Jahmiyyah are named after Jahm ibn Safwan. Jahm ibn Safwan was a particular man, and he is the one that's named after. Unlike other sects that are not necessarily named after one person, like Qadiriyah and Jabariyah are not named after one person, it's named after an idea, whether they believed you write your own Qadr or there is Jabr. But some groups, and we'll talk about this, like the Asharis and the Matrudis, and then we'll talk about these groups are named after particular people. So Jahmiyyah were named after Jahm ibn Safwan, who was a man born in Kufa. He moved to Tirmidh, and Tirmidh is where Imam al-Tirmidhi is from. And his da'wah began when he started taking Ilmul Kalam. And we talked about the evils of Ilmul Kalam. Until today, there are madaris and so-called colleges and universities that study and teach and preach Ilmul Kalam and falsafa and these things. So this is not something that's gone from the ummah. This study, it influenced the Mu'tazila, and we discussed the Mu'tazila in the last dars. But Jahm ibn Safwan was also somebody who was very early in this period. This was at the end of the Amawiyyah, so it's the early time in the Muslim ummah. He started to study Greek philosophy, ilm al-kalam, and studying that, he started to hold ideas, and he was one of the first people to hold the idea that the Quran is not the kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is makhluq. This was a bid'ah that Jahm ibn Safwan came up with. And he was one of the early people that started promoting this idea. Why? Because if you look at the Salaf al-Salihin, the earlier generation, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, the great imma of Islam, Abu Hanifa and Shafi'i and Malik and Ahmad and others, they all held a very pure aqidah that the Quran is the kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, غير مخلوق. But Jahm ibn Safwan, he wanted to understand everything in accordance to the rules of the Greek in the rules of Aristotle. And they said that if you say that the Quran is the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you have to ascribe to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala something that we hear and read. And they started to go into this useless debate. The a'immah before them, they didn't go into this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called the Qur'an His kalam. Khalas, we believe in it. That's it. It is ghair makhluq. Anything that is connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His ilm, His sight, His hearing, everything is ghair makhluq. So the Qur'an is ghair makhluq. We don't get into, well, what about the huruf, and what about the waraqat, and what about my recitation? We don't need to get into all of this. So, Jahm, because of his influence, he started to reject this idea. He went further in his bid'ah, and he started to say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not have any asma and no sifat. Subhanallah. وَلِلَّهِ أَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى. We see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that for Allah are the beautiful asma and the beautiful sifat. The Qur'an is filled with the beautiful asma of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sifat. And alhamdulillah, in these durus, we went over all of the asma of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that are found in the Qur'an in Sahih Ahadith. And there are many more that we don't know about, that only Allah knows about. But the Jahmiyyah, they rejected them. Now this sounds strange, but there are people that have this ideology today. Because when the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, when the Muslims, they said, no, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has beautiful asma, because in the Qur'an, because this is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us, he has beautiful sifat, because he has described himself with them in the Qur'an, and that is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us in the Sahih Ahadith. Then these Jahmiyyah, they will tell the Muslims, they will tell the people on the right aqidah, they will tell them, you are mujassima. And this bid'ah, this accusation is alive today. Today, when the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about himself that he has a wajh and a yad and whatever he has described himself in the Qur'an, without tashbih, without making the likeness to any creation, just believing in it because Allah has said it, they say, oh, if you say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears, you're mujassima. You are, in English they have a word, anthropomorphism. I don't know why they put so many syllables in there. Mujassima is easy for us. They say that this is an accusation they put against Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah till today. And alhamdulillah, the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, those upon the aqidah of the Salaf al Salihin, those upon the aqidah of the Athar, of following the aqidah Athariyah, those following the aqidah of the Sahaba, those following the aqidah of the Hanabila, those earlier imma who stood up for the right aqidah, are free from being mujassima. Because we do not make tashbih of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the jism of any makhluk. We only believe in what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, in the zahir of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed, unless there is a dalil to show majaz. We believe in it. This is what's in the Quran. This is what the Prophet told us. So we are free from the accusations today and from the time of the earlier a'imma of the people of bid'ah. الشيخ عبد القادر الجيلاني الشيخ عبد القادر الجيلاني he writes in his famous book غنة الطالبين that the Jahmiyyah are ascribed to Jahm ibn Safwan, and what is their aqidah he recorded in his book. First, they said iman is only ma'rifah, and this aqidah is alive today. I don't know if anybody today that comes out and says we are Jahmiyyah, or we are Murji'ah, or we are Mu'tazila. Maybe there is, but I don't know. But I do know of people today, there are lectures on YouTube today from du'at who call themselves ulama and du'at in America and other countries that call towards some aspects of this aqidah. And I'm not mentioning names, but you will, when you understand the issue, then you will know who it is. The first thing they say, that iman is only ma'rifah. Yani, if you know that there is one Allah, then this is enough. This is iman. You don't have to have يعني التصديق باللسان. You don't have to have بالعمال. That iman has nothing to do with declaration or actions. We the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, and when we study these batil firq, يعني these sects that are misguided, we refute them so you can know, and those watching and the sisters and brothers here, the right aqidah. We don't want to study the wrong just to study wrong, we want to make rad of them. So what is their aqidah? That if you know there is one Allah, if that's something in your heart, this is it. This is enough. And today, you will see people that will say, if you believe in your heart, this is it. But we the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, our aqidah from the time of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum till the Day of Judgment is iman begins in the heart. The aqidah begins in the heart, but it is not restricted to the heart. It has to come and be declared with the tongue and shown with action. Shown with action. A'mal, actions are a part of iman. As we know from the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that iman has branches. Yani they are shu'ab of iman. And the lightest of them to move something harmful from the path. Is that an action or no? Is that an action? Yes. And that is from iman. And we believe that iman increases and decreases. This is the aqidah of the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. And the one who says that iman does not increase or decrease, if you believe, khalas, you're all the same, then this is the murji', and we'll discuss them. Jahmiyyah, they believe that iman is only in the heart. Actions are not a part of iman. They claim the Quran is makhluq. The Quran is not the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, غير makhluq. They claim that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not speak to Musa alayhi salam. And the Asharis and the Maturudis and others later will take from them some aspects, and we'll discuss them in the later durus. We believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to Musa alayhi salam. Why? Because in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to Musa alayhi salatu salam. We believe in that. The Jahmiyyah said no. Why? Because they said the makhluk, they speak. And if you say that Allah speaks and the makhluk, they speak, then you're mujassima. No. The Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, we know the makhluk speak, but the Khaliq, his speaking is unique to him. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. He speaks. Why? Because he said in the Quran that he does. But it is his speaking and our speaking is not the same. He sees, subhanahu wa ta'ala, but his seeing and our seeing is not the same. He hears, subhanahu wa ta'ala, but his seeing and his hearing is not like our seeing and hearing. Our speech is limited. Our speech is limited by time and space and all these things. Our sight is limited. Our hearing is limited. The kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is unlimited. He reveals it to who He wants when He wants. The seeing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is unlimited. He sees everything without any hindrance. The hearing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is unlimited. He hears everything without limited. We have knowledge, but our knowledge is limited. Nothing compared to the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has knowledge. It's unlimited. The Jahmiyyah, they rejected this because it didn't fit with Greek philosophy and Greek mythology and Greek thought and Aristotle's rules. And ilm al-kalam, and falsafa, and these useless things. The Jahmiyyah believe that you will not see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the hereafter. And today we have people on YouTube and other places giving talks. Well, you can't actually see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because if you see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then it would have to have direction, and it would have to have this, and it would have to have that. And they just go with this useless conversation. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us in the Sahih Hadith, he asked the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum, that do you have any difficulty seeing the full moon on a clear night? If the night is clear and the moon is full, do you have any difficulty seeing the moon? No. He says, like this, you will see your Rabb subhanahu wa ta'ala in the akhirah. Khalas. Close. We don't need to talk about direction and this and that, and well, what about the physical side, and then you're giving location. What? Did the Prophet tell us this? No. Isn't the Quran? No. Did the Sahaba discuss it? No. Khalas, put it away. Let it die with their Aristotle and Homer and Pluto and I don't know, whatever else. They did not believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above his arsh. Ar-Rahmanu ala al-arsh istawa. We find so many times, man fi sama, in the Quran. But then, the Jahmiyyah, and later we'll talk about the arsh is ma'turi. There are many people today, they have this aqidah, they don't believe that Allah is above the arsh. When Allah told us in the Quran, when the Prophet ﷺ told us in a hadith, khalas, we believe it. That's it. Allah is above the samawat. We know this from the Quran and Sahih Ahadith. And if we ask somebody the question, where is Allah? In Allah. Many people say, haram, you can't ask this question. Why? The Prophet ﷺ asked this question in the Sahih Hadith. And the woman who answered, she pointed, she's above the samawat. The Prophet ﷺ then believed in her to be a believer. And we'll discuss this hadith in detail later. But I'm just saying for now, to understand the rad on the Jahmiyyah, that we believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above the samawat upon his arsh. And he makes nuzul in a way that befits him. Because he told us. And his Prophet told us. That's it. And to ask this question of somebody is not a bid'ah. Something that was done by the Prophet ﷺ. But the Prophet ﷺ didn't do it all the time. We don't see him walking around with the Sahaba and asking, where is Allah? Where is Allah? So don't go to the other extreme. Some brothers, every masjid they go to, first thing, where is Allah? Keep everything in its place. But if you want to know if somebody's aqidah is sahih or not, and you ask them that question, there's nothing wrong with it. As the Prophet ﷺ wanted to know if this woman was a believer or not, and he asked her. They didn't believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has an arsh or a kursi. The Jahmiyyah, they said Allah has no arsh and no kursi. And we tell them in the Quran, what about ayatul kursi? What about the ayat about the arsh of ar-Rahman? What about all these ayat? What about these ahadith? They would say, these are majazan. There is a different meaning. We'll give another meaning to it. Who gave you that authority to change the meaning of the kalam of Allah? Did the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum give it a different meaning? In the Arabic language, the zahir of it a different meaning? No. Then khalas, you have to stick to the Quran and what it is. But the Jahmiyyah, they would take anything that didn't fit their Greek philosophy, give it a different meaning. Until today, many a madaris, many a jami'at, they have this aqidah. And they will say, no. Arsh, what is meant by arsh is the universe, and what is meant by kursi is this, and what is meant by the yad is nusra, and what is meant by ayn is this and that, and they will give all these meaning majazan without haqq. And we make rad of this. They believe there is no mizan on the day of judgment. They believe there is no azab al-qabr. Until today, many of the sects like Hizb al-Tahrir and others, they would come out and say, there is no Azab al-Qabr. And misguided people who want to make themselves popular on TV and things, like Ghamadi and others, Jawed al-Ghamadi in Pakistan and others, they would come out and say, no Azab al-Qabr. Why? No, there are so many ahadith for it. There is ayat in Quran that point towards it. But because they want to change Islam, they want to corrupt Islam, they come and say these things. And inshallah we'll discuss Adab al-Qabr as a separate subject later in these durus. They believed that Al-Jannah and Al-Nar, the Jannah and the Nar are two created things that will come to an end. They believed that there will be a time there will be no more Jannah and no more Nar. If there is no more Jannah, خَالَدِينَ فِيهَا, what's going to happen to those that will be in it forever? If there is no more Nar, what's going to happen to those that are going to be abadan fiha? Because they said every makhluk has to have an end. We say no. Every makhluk has a beginning. Allah has no beginning. His kalam has no beginning. But if Allah wills it, and as Allah has shown it in the Quran, that the believers will be in Jannah forever without end, and the kuffar will be in the nar forever without end. And here I want to make a point, as one of the earlier speakers here in this masjid made a mistake, who said that Ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullah alayh held the view that the nar will come to an end, and this is something wrong. Shaykh al-Islam Taqiyuddin Ibn Taymiyyah did not hold this view. He mentioned that this is a view in Majmu' al-Fatawa, but this was not his view. Those that ascribe it to him are his enemies. Those that he defeated in debate and shame, they wrote this in their books. And his student Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawziyah in Wabr al-Salib, in his sharh of Kalam al-Tayyib, he made rad of those who said this about Ibn Taymiyyah, and he clarified that Ibn Taymiyyah did not hold this view. The Jahmiyyah, they held that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not speak to his creation, nor will he look at them in the Day of Judgment. And Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, we have the view that we will see our Rabb subhanahu wa ta'ala in Jannah. We will hear our Rabb subhanahu wa ta'ala in Jannah. And we'll talk about the seeing and hearing on the Day of Judgment and the difference between that and that of Jannah, insha'Allah ta'ala. And we will hear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala read Surah Ar-Rahman to us in Al-Jannah. Because that's what we find in Sahih Ahadith. And those that are closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Jannah, and the higher levels of Jannah, will see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala more frequently. But the people of Jannah, will the greatest blessing they will have is they will see their Rabb subhanahu wa ta'ala pleased with them. But the Jahmiyyah, they denied this. The Jahmiyyah, they held the view that Iman is just knowledge in the heart and not actions. And we discussed this already. And they rejected all of the sifat and asma of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is what Abdul Qadir al-Gaylani, he mentioned Ghunyat al-Talibin. Now, what we find in the later ulama who made rad of the Jahmiyyah, that according to the Jahmiyyah, Iman is only ma'rifa in the qalb. It is just to know in the heart. Now pay attention. So the Jahmiyyah said that Iblis, la'natullah alayhim, Iblis, al-Shaytan, and Fir'aun, and the Yahud of Medina, and Abu Talib, and the Quraysh, and the Munafiqun, their Iman was the same as Abu Bakr, and Umar, and Uthman, and Ali. Subhanallah. Now this sounds shocking to us, right? But there are people today, on YouTube, they have videos, they say, Iman is in the heart and that's it. Okay, so if Iman is only knowing that there is Allah, do you think Iblis doesn't know there is Allah? You think Fir'aun didn't know there is Allah? Didn't the Munafiqun know there is Allah? Didn't the Yahud of Medina know there is Allah? Didn't the Quraysh know there is Allah? When you ask them that who created the samawat, qalu, Allah. You think many enemies of Islam that hate Islam today, they don't know the Quran to be haqq? Many of the people who became murtad and fought against the Muslims, when against Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, didn't they know the Quran? Weren't there people that went to Musaylim al-Kadhaa and told him, Wallahi, we know you're a Kadib. And we know the Quran is Haqq. But Al Kadib from our Qom, Ahabbali, is more beloved to me than a Sadiq min al Quraysh, than a one who is a truthful from the Quraysh. So if the Jahmiyyah were correct, then all of those would be at the same level of Iman. And we, the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, we reject this. We say just knowing in the heart is not enough. You have to accept Islam. You have to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even though people will sin, we're not saying you have to be perfect. We're not saying you have to be perfect. A Muslim can be a fasiq. He can do major sins. We don't make takfir like the Khawarij. It's not our aqeedah. But we say that iman is in the heart, is upon the tongue, and in action. And they have to do some good action in a lifetime. Because this is the effect of iman. The Jahmiyyah, they would say that statements of kufr, like cursing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger, and saying that Allah is one of three, and saying that Allah has children or Allah is created, na'udhu billah, na'udhu billah. But they would say that these things do not make you a kafir. SubhanAllah. We're not talking about jahl. If somebody does something out of jahl, they're jahil, that's a different issue. But the Jahmiyyah would say that if somebody knows well and good, but still they make kalamat of kufr, and even when the hujjah is established on them, they continue to make kalamat of kufr, that person is still a Muslim. He still has iman. He's still from the people of Jannah. He's at the same level as Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman and Ali. SubhanAllah. And today we find this. Only God can judge me, and all these weird statements that come out. Today we find people that are an 8-hour or 9-hour drive from here that will go to a synagogue. I'm not mentioning any names. And they will say, so what? If somebody is Jewish, they know there is Allah. They're still going to Jannah. Different path. So what? If somebody is a Christian, they're still going to Jannah. How can you judge? Even if somebody says that Allah is as a child and a son, but they know Allah, they believe in Allah, they're not kuffar. Na'udhu billah. Masajid in our city. Not going to mention how long of a drive, maybe half an hour, 40 minutes north. They will come out and say that if somebody is a Christian or a Jew, or you cannot say they're going to hell. They believe in Allah. Na'udhu billah. We say, no, you have to believe in Allah as Allah has ordained it. If you believe Allah to be one of three, this is not Allah. This is your misconception. If you believe in Allah to have a son named Uzair, or a son named Isa, or a father, or a cousin, or a roommate, or any of these kinds of shirk, aqa'id, this is kufr. This is the people of an-nar. It's our aqeedah. And we don't care who gets offended by it. We stick to it. The Jahmiyyah, they said, if somebody makes sujood to a salib, or to an idol, or kills somebody without cause, or does any of these things, they are still perfect believers. They're still perfect believers. Because in their heart, if they had ma'rifah, khalas. And we, the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, we don't believe in this. We believe if somebody does an act of kufr, knowing and understanding it to be kufr, and the hujjah has established this person from that act, even if they have ma'rifah in their heart, they become kafir. Now we do not believe, as the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, that if somebody does something out of ignorance, we don't make them from the Ahlul Nar. And we do not believe that a sin will make you from the Ahlul Nar. But we do believe that tark of certain a'mal can make you kafir, like salah. Now, the Jahmiyyah, they were refuted and they were put down by the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, like imma of the aqeedah, like Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, who wrote Rad Ahl Jahmiyyah, and he destroyed their da'wah. Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, he destroyed their da'wah. And that's why he's called Imam Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Because he didn't just stand up for a madhab or a people, but he stood up for the entire ummah, for the Ahnaf and the Shawafi'ah and the Malikiyah and others. He stood up for the aqeedah of Islam. Imam Ahmad, he said, as his student Abu Bakr al-Marwazi, he reports that Imam Ahmad said, I heard someone say, Abu Bakr al-Marwazi says, that I heard someone say to Abu Abdullah, Abu Abdullah is Imam Ahmad. That Abdul Wahhab was speaking and he said, whoever claims that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to Musa alayhi salam without a voice, then he is Jahmi and an enemy of Allah and an enemy of Islam. So Abu Abdullah, yani Imam Ahmad, said, how beautiful is what he said, may Allah have mercy on him. Abdul Wahhab is not Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, who came very later. Somebody will say Imam Ahmad was a Wahhabi now. So this is Abdul Wahhab, a great muhaddith and scholar from the earlier generations. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab is many, many generations later a great scholar of Islam as well. So we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to Musa alayhi salam directly, clearly. Musa alayhi salam heard Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what we find in the Quran and this is what we believe. Abdullah, the Imam of the Muslims, the great scholar and the son of Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, and a great scholar in his own right. Salih and Abdullah, both of his sons, great scholars as well. He said that I said to my father, yani Imam Ahmad, verily there are those who say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not speak to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam with a voice. He, Imam Ahmad, said, these are the people of Bid'ah, the people of Jahmiyyah, they denied the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The great scholar of Islam, the great leader of the ulama of hadith, Imam Bukhari, also made rad of the Jahmiyyah. He said, verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls with a voice that is heard from afar as it is heard from near. This is the difference between our voice and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's voice. As there are many, it is not even comparable. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls, it is heard from afar and near, and whenever and wherever Allah wills. Our voices are limited. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is unlimited. He reveals His voice to whoever He wants, wherever He wants. Imam Bukhari says, so this does not change that for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is a proof that the voice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not resemble the makhluk. We are not mujassima. Because the voice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is heard from afar and near and wherever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills it. Shaykh al-Islam, Taqiyuddin ibn Taymiyyah, Abu al-Abbas, the great scholar of Islam, he refuted the Jahmiyyah as well. And he says, so it becomes clear that the outright righteousness of actions cannot be a fruit of internal iman, nor can they be an effect, except that the internal iman necessitates them by obligation and requires them. What does that mean? Ibn Taymiyyah says that when you have iman, it will obligate you to do good deeds. Not saying that you will do every good deed. Not saying that you will not sin. But when you have iman, you will do some good deeds. So just having ma'rifah is not enough. There has to be some, even a single action in a lifetime, but there has to be some action. Thus, it is necessary that amal, actions, are tied with iman. And its effect is tied with the cause. As the outward obligations of actions decreases, then this is to the decrease of the iman in the heart. What does that mean? Our iman will increase and decrease. When your iman increases, your amal will get better. And will increase your good deeds. And when iman decreases, your iman, when it decreases, your amal will decrease. And they will become of less value. If you want to weigh your iman, then think, how good is your salah? How good is your dua? How good is your reading of Quran? How good is your love for halaqat of ilm? How good is your love for the people of ilm? And then you will know your iman. And this is just a few of the characteristics from many. And if you want to know your iman, but your salah is getting worse, your khushu is getting worse, your love for the people of ilm is getting worse, your love for the people of fisq and fujar and kuffar is increasing. Let me give you an example. If a person of ilm invites you to come sit down with them, how happy do you become? And if a person of fisq and kufr but he has power. And he has maybe a house that's white. Just saying. And he has authority. And he has money. And he invites you and you become really happy. You change your name from something Yusuf to something handsome. You decide to go back to your old name. And you dress up really nice. And you become really happy. You shake hands. Or let's say some fasiq, fajir, kafir rapper decides to give you the honor to take a picture with you. And you're twittering and you're so happy. No need for explanation. This kafir. I'm not mentioning any names. Right? But when the Ahlul Ilm, the people of Ilm, the people of the Quran and Sunnah, the people of the right Aqidah, invite you to sit down and discuss, you don't have time for that. You gotta go to concerts. Then you know your Iman. May Allah protect us. This was the Jahmiya, and now, inshallah, I will quickly discuss the Murji'. The Murji' came from the Jahmiyyah. They had similar roots. And in many forms, they're alive today. And there are many types of the Murji'. But the essence of the Murji' is they said that the sinner is the same as a pious person in Iman. He said Iman does not increase or decrease. The Murji', their aqidah was that Iman does not increase and it does not decrease. Zada imanuhum. We find in the Quran that the Iman increases. We find in ahadith that the Iman decreases. For example, the Sahih hadith where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was approached by Abu Bakr and Hanzala radiallahu anhuma, who were saying they felt an effect on them that made them doubt themselves. Because these were pious people. Unlike us today, we think, mashallah, I'm guaranteed Jannah. Astaghfirullah. Hanzala radiallahu anhu, he was sitting with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Iman increased. Iman increases. He went home, started joking and being with his family. His Iman decreased. He said, I saw a change. I thought I'm a munafiq. Because they were believers, they were afraid of nifaq. They went out in the street. Hanzala said, I'm a munafiq. Hanzala is a munafiq. Abu Bakr then told him, what's wrong with you? What are you saying? We know you to be a good mu'min, a Muslim. He said, this is my condition. Abu Bakr then said, it's my condition as well. When I'm with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, my Iman increases. When I go home and have to deal with things, my Iman decreases. Maybe I'm a munafiq too. They both went to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, no. Iman, it increases and decreases. If your Iman was always at that high level, always increasing, then Malaika would shake hands with you in the streets. And this is the test. But this is the importance for the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah to be in the good environment. To be in halaqat of ilm. To be around good brothers and sisters. To listen to that which benefits you. So that your Iman continues to increase. And when it decreases, you bring it back. But the Murji', they said the Iman does not increase and decrease. Iman of everybody is the same. Subhanallah. And this today is promoted by some people as well. Some of them believe that anyone who says La ilaha illallah is guaranteed Jannah even if they don't believe in it. The Murji', they said, if you say La ilaha illallah, you will go to Jannah even if you don't believe in it. Subhanallah. And this is some of the people today. We find somebody who says La ilaha illallah, but then they commit an act of clear and major kufr. Knowingly, they speak against the Sharia, they speak against the Quran, and they kill the Muslims, and they help the kuffar. And they say clearly that there is better ways of governance than the Sharia. They come out and say that the Sharia is outdated. Na'udhu billah. They say the Sharia was for all time. We need a new way. They come out and say these things. We say, subhanallah, if you feel that the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not applicable, that it's outdated, needs to be updated, we need American Islam, whatever. If you feel that the Quran and Sunnah are not applicable, there's a way of governance better than the Quran and Sunnah, this is kufr. They say, oh, making kufr. The Quran makes kufr on them. The ahadith make kufr on them. The ulama of Islam have made kufr on them, not just us. If you come out and say and believe that there is a way to govern better than the Quran and Sunnah, whether you call it democracy or communism or this ism or that ism or modernism or this or that, it's kufr. Now here, the murji'ah say, no, it's okay, he's Muslim, he said la ilaha illallah. No matter if he talks bad about the Quran, if he talks bad about the Prophet ﷺ, if he talks bad about the Sharia, he said la ilaha illallah, he's going to Jannah. This is not the aqidah of the Ahlu Sunnah wal Jama'ah. This is the aqidah of the murji'ah, and many murji'ah there today. They denied Qadr, and they were considered, the murji'ah were considered a sect that came out of the Qadariya. Because they denied Qadr, they believed you write your own Qadr, you control Qadr. They held many of the views of Jahm ibn Safwan and the Jahmiyyah. The word murjih comes from irja', the root word comes from the word of araja, which is to postpone. And why were they called murjih? Because they believe that the issue of Islam and kufr has to be postponed to Allah. Only God can judge me. This is a murjih. No, in Islam, alhamdulillah, we have qadis and ulama that give hukam, including hukam on people's Islam and kufr. But this is not the job of the average person to make kufr on people. This is the job of the ulama. But we have ulama and we give order. We are not like the murji'ah. The murji'ah, they deferred actions, amal, to al-Iman and to everything. And they said that even if somebody says La ilaha illallah and commits clear kufr, they are from the people of Jannah. We defer their judgment to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A Shaykh Muhammad Saleh ibn Uthaymeen, he said about al-istihlal, and we'll discuss what that is, having to do with the murji'ah, is that a person believes that something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be haram is halal. And as for istihlal of action, then we need to observe that if it is done, is related to something that expels something, someone from the religion, then a person becomes a kafir because of it. And I'll explain. For example, if a person worked with riba, without believing it to be halal, yet he persists in working in it, then does that person become a disbeliever or not? He says it does not make them a disbeliever if they do not consider it to be halal. If somebody does a sin, but they don't consider it to be halal, then that does not make them a kafir. This is not the aqidah of the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. However, if he says the riba is halal, Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen says, then he becomes a kafir. It's very important. My brothers and sisters in Islam, this is very important for us to understand. Sometimes a person may sin. Maybe they'll listen to something haram. Maybe they'll do something haram. This does not make them a kafir. But when you say that haram is halal, that makes a person kafir. Unless they do it out of mistake, out of being jahil, that's separate. So if somebody, for example, drinks khamar, it's a very major sin, from the major sins. But they don't say it's halal, they're a fasiq, but they're still Muslim. We don't call them kafir. But somebody drinks khamar and says, what's wrong with khamar? Drink it, no problem with it. This person becomes a kafir. So you have to be very careful. And the same is true for many other things that are haram. So before you make something halal, be very careful. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made something halal and you make it haram, you have to be very careful with that as well. If you do it out of jahl, out of being jahil, or a mistake in ijtihad, that's different. But if you know it to be halal, you make it haram, you'd lie on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's also kufr. So you have to be very careful with these issues. And we should always turn to the people of ilm regarding to these issues. So if a person says riba is halal, and he intends by it that riba that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made haram is halal, this person's a kafir. Since he is a denier of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam has said. So in these circumstances, istihlal, making halal of that which is haram, can make a person kafir. Now I want to make a note. If somebody does it out of ignorance, then it doesn't count. However, istihlal in action, then we need to look at the action itself. The Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen is saying, in some things, it may take somebody out of Islam. For example, as Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen mentions, that if somebody makes tark of salah, they make tark, they totally leave salah, then leaving that action can make somebody a kafir, even if they don't believe it not to be far. May Allah protect us. And there are many other cases that we can discuss, but for the sake of time, we'll end here. But we will mention a summary. As Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen, he mentions, the madhab of the murji' is centered around the misunderstanding of iman. Most of their followers, they said, it is just the affirmation in the heart. Some of them said, you have to have confession by the tongue. Some of them even left that out. But what we know is that iman is in the heart, on the tongue, and in actions. As the Prophet ﷺ told us, as the hadith in Sahih Muslim, that iman has 70 some odd branches. The most superior of them is to say La ilaha illallah, and the lowest of them to remove something harmful from the road. And al-haya, modesty, is a shu'bah, is a branch of iman. That is an action. And also from the Sahih of Imam Muslim, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, iman is establishing the salah and giving of zakah and fasting in Ramadan. All these actions have to do with iman. So iman is, it begins in the heart. And then it is something that is said by the tongue. And for the one who cannot speak, by ishara. And it is something that comes out in action. That is iman according to Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. The murji' have many sects. They split into smaller sects. As Sheikh Saleh al-Fawzan, he says, what are the types of the murji'? When he was asked, he said, the murji' are of four types. The murji' are of four types. One, those who say iman is merely ma'rifah, even if it is not accompanied by tasdeeq bil lisan. The first type of murji', and this from Sheikh Saleh al-Fawzan, are those that say iman is only in the heart, even without saying anything in the tongue. And this is the statement of the Jahmiyyah, and this is one of the types of the murji'. And Sheikh Saleh al-Fawzan says this is the most evil and the ugliest of the statements, and this in fact is kufr in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm not making takfir, this is the takfir of Sheikh Saleh al-Fawzan. Because the mushrikun from the early times, like Fir'aun and Hammam and Qarun and Iblis and others, then they would say that they are those that are believers. However, because they did not state on their tongue and they did not testify to this with their actions, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made kufr on them, and these people deny that. The second type of murji' are those that say iman is only by the heart and tasdeeq of the lisan. And many people today, they believe this. And this is the statement of the Asharis as well. And this is also false, since the kuffar, many of them, They may know that there is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they may say it, but if they do not make taslim of it, like the munafiqun in the time of Medina, those that the Prophet ﷺ said will be in the worst parts of Jahannam. And the Quran and the Prophet ﷺ, they have made rad on this. So this is also incorrect. The third type are the ones that say that the statement of those who are direct in opposition to the Ashariya and the Karamiya, those who say that Iman is a statement on the tongue, even if they don't believe it in the heart. And this is one of the sects of the Murji'. They said that you just say La ilaha illallah, you don't even have to believe it, and you're from the people of Jannah. And without doubt, as Sheikh Salih Al-Fawzan says, without a doubt, this is a false statement, since the munafiqun, when they will be in the worst parts of Jahannam, those that say with their tongue, La ilaha illallah, but they don't believe it in their hearts. And this is something that is denied in the Quran and the Sahih Ahadith. The fourth type are the murji' of the fuqaha, al-murji' al-fuqaha. And they are the lightest of these groups. The worst was the first, and they are the lightest. And they are the ones that say that Iman is something that is in the heart and upon the tongue, but the actions don't enter into it, and they do not increase nor do they decrease, and they are also misguided, because we find in the Quran and the Sahih Ahadith that Iman increases and decreases. This is the Jahmiyyah and the Murji'ah and their false beliefs, and what is the rad on them, and what is the correct Aqidah of the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Insha'Allah, we'll continue with the other sects at the next Dars, next Jum'ah. Jazakumullahu khairan.